even more.
We don't, and that's why ECHO is taking care of it, of this. So now we have found an amazing house for lots of women.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Well, it turns out we're all in the service of ECHO. So legend making is part of our job. So what are we doing? I'm trying to figure out where we are in the Building Love That Lasts book, because we've been in an earthquake zone.
No, we're before that. We were like starting the archetypal.
Have it. Not, like,
no, we haven't even done that part.
No way.
Yeah,
we have got amazing stuff to
the pirate woman. No. So while Clinton looks for this, I was thinking, I was thinking of coming back to reading the book and the study group, and I thought, what is really this study group? Like, what is this really about? Because it's not a training space, so we can't, you know, we're not allowed to basically put us in breakout room and do practice, because people come here to study. And
it's a safe place.
It's a safe place. You can even keep your video, your camera off, and we won't say anything. Whereas Habet, we're glad to see you. Whereas in training spaces, in my fear club, you can't hide. And then the question is, okay, what is this about? So one of the thing that this is about is to find out our incompetence, is to face into our incompetence of, in this case, relating. And it's not really a habit in possibility management to be faced with incompetence and not have spaces to remedy that incompetence. And so what I've found is that what happens is that everybody starts creating practice spaces for themselves. And so just in the last weeks, there's the heart gym that came out, the letting your heart speak. And even when I was thinking of the first study group, this is really where we started all delivering Rage Club. And people would say, I'm delivering the next Rage Club. And it's like, okay, great, let's all go to this Rage Club. And then 4 weeks later, the next person starts, and everybody from the study group would go to the following Rage Club and Fear Club and work talks. And so I like that. I mean, it's not just I like that, but I think what I discovered is that in a way, this study group is one of the heartbeats of the village, like the community of possibility management. And that it's important, or it this is one of the village making, like, it's a village making action to create some kind of heartbeat. And so I know some of you are village makers in Berlin, in Canada, in Brazil, in Florianopolis. And so I found that they have this consistency and this commitment, and this is the place where the discovery gets shared and gets put into the field. And then it's like, okay, now we're speaking the same language, and now we're all going through this liquid state of this new discovery, and it gets integrated in the village, and it makes sense. It's like the blood being pumped from the heart. So I really encourage you that if you're delivering, you know, offering practice spaces, to share it, because people also in the recording get access to it and say what the purpose is and when do you meet and for how long and things like that.
Anybody have any of those activities that you're announcing right now? Habet,
for example. I do.
And Nicole, yes. Good. Nicole, you got your mic on. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. I was just sharing this legend in one of the Telegram groups, that this 333 Anger Monday space, it's such a cool mixture of people who are new to anger work and are doing 333 for the first time. And then there are some people who've been doing it, like, I've been doing it 3.5 years.
Yeah.
And
That's way more like that. Three and a half. Yeah.
The new three. And yesterday in the space, there were three men and three women.
Wow.
And I had done the experiment, a new one, because I figured out that some things weren't working for me so well as a space holder in that space. So I recreated the design of the experiment and have been getting half the group to go first while the others use our anger to cheer them on and then giving feedback and coaching and then switching. Mm-hmm. And so the men put up their hands to go first. And so the three women were like, go! And the men came out of the space, like they did their integration minute. They came back to the screen and we were just like, and the men were just like, I mean, it made my day. It's first thing in my Monday morning. And I get to see men rage and women saying, go. And the men like crying and sad because they're being touched by this, the goes from the women. And then this little like micro discovery space with the feedback and coaching, all these distinctions about 333 and conscious anger coming into the space. And then we got to do it again with the woman raging and the men saying go, and this another little, and it's an hour long, and it's such a great way to start the week. And it's also becoming like a, it's like the miniature rage club. Mm-hmm. So, and it's also miniature rage club spaceholder training. Because people have been coming and doing 333 in held spaces are then like, I want to try holding space myself. Mm-hmm. And then it becomes this amazing village weaving space because people who are new are already turning around and inviting their friends for like a taste of Rage Club, a taste of conscious anger. And it's just like, you know, like there's a woman coming. She's like I don't know how old she is. She's got long gray hair. And then there's so many countries were represented. Just so cool. 333 Zoom in spaces are such a cool way to spread conscious anger.
Nicole, how do people find it? How do people get in touch with it?
There's a Telegram group called the 333, and it's like number 333. Zooming crossroads, and you can join that.
I'll put the link in the description of this call. Yeah.
Is it also available through the 333 website? Can people do that?
I think it is on there. I will double check. And also it's in the up calendar.
Yeah.
Great.
Or a lot of the 333 spaces are listed in the team up calendar.
Super.
I want to, the next step, what I discovered in the Fear Club, in the first week, I offered for people to hold space for 1 hour boundary, setting boundaries. And we had 10 minutes per person. It was five women, 10 minutes per person. And it was just for people who can already feel angry and who've already, probably most of them have done standing rage, so they have a sense of what it takes to make a boundary. But we have so many boundaries that we haven't made. And that just, it just makes this safe, the space completely safe. So I'm offering here in this space for whoever, you know, is turned on to hold these micro rage club, like you call them, Nicole, which is called boundary, setting boundary, making boundaries. 1 hour.
Yeah. Thank you.
The Women Starting Over Possibility Team is opening its doors next Friday. So at the beginning of each month, we open the doors for more women to join. We are now 18 women exploring the website every week. And we went through the first one was the box, and there was this amazing discovery about knits. And we did this experiment in breakout rooms to pick a knit and then discover where it came from. And the discovery was that even though the need seems very small, there's usually an emotion, a survival strategy, or something that really impacted the person so that the need was created. And then it opens a possibility for healing and transformation and going through an emotional healing process or dismantling the checking the survival strategy. And by doing so, redesigning the box, which is pretty amazing. I'm really turned on by that. So next Friday, it's possible for new women to join. We are now exploring conscious feelings. So you're welcome.
Is there a place for people to find that group? How do people, is it a possibility on the Possibility Team website?
On the team?
No, not yet. I will take care of that. And I just posted the Telegram group link on the Possibility Creation Village.
Great. Great. Thank you. Somebody else have a doorway like that?
Yes, I'm holding space for, okay, a bit.
No, okay, go, I'm go, going. Isabella. I'm happy you're going because I'm still in the table.
I'm holding space for a possibility team and a structural possibility team. And last week we dived into the energetic body, like discovering how it is connected to feelings, how it is connected to your parts, and what is stopping you from being centered in your energetic body. What is blocking you, and how to hold space for yourself, basically. And it's on Thursday at 2 p.m. Brazilian time and 6 p.m. CT. And we will do a brain surgery this week. Welcome.
Diving deep and fast.
What's the name of the group again?
Inner Structure Possibility Team.
Okay, so it's a possibility team, the theme of inner structure. Okay, great. Yeah. And that's available on the Possibility Team website. People can find it also.
Yes.
Or team up.
Yes.
Yeah, but team up also. But
and we have 14 members.
14.
Right now.
Wow.
Yeah, 14.
No, 40.
40.
Yeah.
40.
You're gonna do 40.
You are in the space clinic.
Yeah, but no.
You are one of the members.
And with brain surgery. No, you're gonna do 40 brain surgeries next semester. 40 brain surgeries. Whatever. No, it's a magnetic surgery. So memes everywhere. Memes crawling around the floor trying to get away. Oh man, thank you.
And I want to add something. I'm making an experiment of being close to a big town and creating a possibility team there. And I'm going to Guarujá, São Paulo, and I'm empowering you. If you know someone who is from São Paulo, to be part of my possibility team, so I will be there for 2 months. And then I will replace myself there. And maybe I will go to the next town and do the next thing. And I don't know, but it's turning me on to do that.
It's like Johnny Appleseed, possibility seed, something like that. Nice, thank you.
Habet.
Yes, I'm offering a rage club and a fear club this month in February, next month, on Monday and Tuesday. The rage club is on Monday and the fear club is on Tuesday for Black, Indigenous, and people of color. And it's also in the team up calendar. Cool. And yeah, I'm also happy if you spread that.
Wow, thank you.
Habet, are most of your people from Berlin, or is it also from other region?
Yeah, they are from all over Germany, but mostly the people who come from other regions, somehow they heard it from the people who were from Berlin. Like the last two rage clubs or three rage clubs, I did not know the people in my trainings.
Cool.
Because it's really, yeah. And that was also, yeah, I suppose there are more offers. But I have another question, Chloe. Not a question, but about what you said with the study group as the heart of this village, because my fear is that, like, I had a session today with someone. I raised my hand that I'm going to be in the team of that person, right, to do the processes, whatever. And what came up in me is that sometimes it's not clear what they actually want. What do they actually want when they call in a team or when they call upon the village to support them? Because the idea that I got is that I'm doing the healing, but that's not what happens. Like I'm just a witness, right? And at some point, the client said, it seems that we are speaking different languages. And that's exactly what I got as well. Like the sense that I got was, wow, we are not speaking about the same thing when we're making distinctions. Yeah, I'm so glad because, again, it's so matching that you open it up with this, because me too, like I've been doing this work now more than 10 years, right? But still, I need to come back here to source again, to, you know, like, because once you get liquid all the time and constantly, it's really important to have some kind of reference point, right? Mm-hmm. To check, what the fuck am I doing here? Why am I doing this? And yeah, my fear is that it's not so clear that this is the village. Like, this is where it actually happens. And all the rest is just training, like labs and spaces where we can practice in a safe space. And my fear is that it becomes something like, wow, it's great because I got so much attention. I have so many people who support me. But in what? But you are the only one to tell us in what. Right? That's my question I'm sitting with right now.
It's even wilder than that in terms of the weaving of the field. Because I don't know why Aunt Chloe said what she said, and I don't know why you're saying what you're saying, but I'm opening the book, and the section where I think we are is called Cultivating the Broken Heart. And it's like, this is where we are. We're cultivating the broken heart. And I just want to read it for a while, and we can talk more later, but because you brought it up again, Habet, it's up, you know, this is the village. The village is cultivating a broken heart. And I'll just read what it says. If you're in the book, it's section 4, page 257. I don't know where else.
Section 8B though, 8D.
8D, the chapter?
If you go down.
Yeah.
Let's go down. Section 8D, how to of archetypal love, 257.
In one way or another, each of us has been wounded. In order to develop the matrix of consciousness upon which our being can grow, our child innocence must in some manner and in some point in time be taken away from us. I'm just going to say that again. Because in order to develop the matrix of consciousness for adulthood, then our childhood, you know, child ego state must in some manner and some point in time be taken away from us. Whether the destruction of our innocence was brutal and extended or precise and swift, it does not so much matter. What matters is that at some point, like now, we gain the clarity about what happened to us from the perspective of a bigger picture about the process we are involved in. What is important is that we come to understand the necessity and value and use of shattered innocence. So in terms of what you were saying, does that hit home, what you're saying? In terms of the heartbeat?
Yeah.
Because it's recontextualizing our lives. And it's like a traditional therapy group would be trying to make us feel better or trying to make us more functional in the modern world so we could do our job or, you know, take care of our family or something like that. That's what a therapy group would be doing. And what we're doing here is recontextualizing the shadowy parts of our lives into a context of transformation. And if that does not take place, then we're left with trying to patch little holes and pretend and make things, you know, cover it over with whipped cream and make it look nice when in fact it is not nice. And what we're doing here is taking the not nice part and making sense of it. It's almost like looking at a garden and going to the poop pile, you know, the compost pile, and go, this is where it all comes from. You don't have a great poop pile. If you don't have a great compost pile that's working for your garden, you won't have a garden. And so in a way, it seems conceptually contradictory in a wellness or well-being or evolution or transformation space to have as our ally, like the dark side, you know, the shadow world, and making and recontextualizing it, putting it to good use. And so when you say that this is the heartbeat, a heartbeat of the village.
Yeah, one of the heartbeats.
Yeah. Yeah, a heartbeat of the village. It's like, okay, this is important, like you said, Habet, is to keep coming back to what the heck are we doing, you know, that it, in a way that makes sense. Because, you know, why are we doing Rage Club? Why are we doing Fear Club? Why are we doing these possibility teams and practicing, you know, a wildly, you know, bizarre skills that there are no job list requirement anywhere in ordinary culture?
Well, I just want to add it. I mean, also for the people listening to the recording, there's a difference between listening to a recording and actually being in this space. Mm. And I mean, one of the differences that there's a particular space with bright principles and a purpose and a context that is held here. And when you're listening to the recording, is you might be doing dishes, you might be in the car, you might be whatever. It's a different space. And the other difference is that whoever you who come here, then you participate in the heartbeat. It's like you are also the heartbeat. And if people don't come, there's no heartbeat anymore. And even it's like if people listen to the recording, they're not sourcing the heartbeat. As part of being responsible for the village.
And I would encourage you to extend that even further to the point of when you're brushing your teeth tonight, you're looking in the mirror and you go, there is a heartbeat. I'm a heartbeater. You know, I'm one of the hearts of the village beating. As part of your, you know, in a way, you're sacrificing these couple hours of your day or this week. You're like sacrificing it to be participating in the heartbeat of the village. And that it is the thing that you get fed from. You know, you have to imagine that the heart also gets fed by the blood that goes through it. It isn't like just pumping blood for everybody else. The heart also gets blood going through it, you know, the oxygen and the nutrients and all that. And so when you become part of the heartbeat, and you let it go through you and you're more aware of it, that you're actually participating in the village in a central way. It's not a superior thing, but it is a definite contribution, like a huge contribution, and let the reciprocal feeding happen between you and what goes through you, even if you are not saying a lot. You know, like, for example, you know, Mark, I don't know, you've been here for years, and I've seen you change so much, and I've changed so much, and it's such an amazing thing. And a lot of times you'll only say three words in a meeting, or, you know, one sentence or whatever. And it's like, but then you're definitely one of these heartbeat, part of this heartbeat. And I think that I would ask everybody, I think, what is everybody, what do you, like, how many people would say that you've gotten, like, you can feel Mark's attention when he's in this space? How many people can feel Mark's, even if he's not saying anything, you can just feel his presence? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's just such a great thing in terms of the heart beating in the village. And we're doing this kind of alchemical magic by holding space for this study group, and it's cruising along. And Chloe just indicated that we've got major territory to go through in the next year.
I wanted to say, so I was thinking, just have it, one of the questions you can ask, you know, when you're sensing this conversation, like this different language, one of the thing I was thinking just now is, you could say, well, which heartbeat do you go to? Like, which heartbeat do you go, you know, do you participate in?
Who's the you?
Well, whoever, you know, Habet, or whoever you're talking to, if you feel like there's this context difference, it's like, where are you getting fed? Like, because, you know, even, for example, the evolution of the healing village came from this pain of this, the spaceholder team, which is Gabriel Le Chemin and Nicole Bradford, you were in there for a long time, and Nicole Nette, of, okay, the healing village is not a free hotline, like a free catharsis hotline, you know, people call in panic mode of, like, you know, I'm having a triggered emotion, like, let me try to talk to somebody. This is not what this is about, actually. This is actually about building a certain kind of matrix to be able to go through powerful processes and be able to hold space for other people to go through these processes and evolving that matrix. Okay, well, where are people building that matrix to actually become, you know, more elegant, better, or more a wider context or a deeper context of space holding for EHPs? And it just started, basically, we had this conversation a few months ago about having a monthly scale up for the healing village. And the heartbeat is kind of like, the scale up is just like, it's kind of like a small baby heartbeat. Let's say it like that. It's like a small baby heartbeat. And so, okay, let's feed it so that it grows and that it can be heard. It can be heard, you know, wider and further. But I think part of it is also for us who are village, arc and village maker, that as we, you know, we, whatever, deepen our context of how does arc and village work, really? How does it go? Like, how do you build an arc and village, you know, not just land-based, but also, a local village or a global village in this case? It's like, okay, we're discovering that it needs this thing called a heartbeat. And so then we can start having this conversation with people of being like, which heartbeat are you beating in? Like, which heartbeat are you flowing blood to? And you getting fed by? Because if you're not, then you're not in the village. You're just eating. And it's fine for a while, you know, baby breastfeed and stuff like that. But it does not, at some point, you will hit, like, people will hit a ceiling very fast about how to participate if they're not, like, being reciprocal, like Clinton was saying. And so that can be a door for us to keep opening, saying, hey, how are you reciprocating? How are you participating? Even just with attention.
Mm-hmm.
Even just with your attention, that is participation.
And it also, in a very real sense, we are learning a different language. And so we even have a website that just says that. It's just, we're learning the language called Arkan. What is Arkan? It is the language of archaearchy. So there's this, I've noticed over the last year or two, when I write a spark or I write a newsletter, sometimes I write a paragraph that almost every other word is a link to a whole website, because I'm using vocabulary from the Arkan language. So what that means is we can have whole conversations in Arkan language, Arkan distinctions, that make so much sense in this field, in this game world. And yet, if somebody else was listening to you, they would just be shaking your head, go, I don't understand a word that you said. And I mean, that's why the links are in there. So that if you find a word that you don't understand, you click and you boom, there's a whole website with context and exercises and diagrams and videos and all this stuff just to unfold that distinction. But how do you welcome people into a new language? Well, really the best way is to speak the language. Go ahead a bit.
Yeah, my fear is they are already there and they are using the words. And they use it differently, seemingly, because otherwise there wouldn't be this perception of speaking different languages. That, like, I'm not speaking about people who haven't been in the context. I'm speaking about people who are already in Fear Club and who have done gremlin transformation or whatever and ask for a team. And then I am one of those space holders. And then checking, like, okay, what are you here for? What is what you need? And I'm speaking from my fear of bringing my people into this whole village, because my idea is that, oh, maybe it's just my imagination, that we are all kind of gatekeepers, right? And they come through me now as a gate, but it could be anybody. And then they land there in the middle of the village or at the heart or meeting people in the village. And the power of this language is that it works in every language, right? Like, I mean, it's feelings language. So we have all feelings. It's universal language. So what's the problem? And the problems can only come from box and gremlin. Mm-hmm. But if we don't mean the same thing by box and gremlin, that's the problem. This is where I see it needs the substance, like the blood, like really like coming and getting the food and being part, like, to me, it's 90% of what I learn it in between those spaces, right? Like, because I come from some kind of incidents and I come to you and I tell you about it and I get feedback and coaching possible, but it's in my life. It's happening in my life. It's not happening in these spaces. And my fear is that people have misunderstandings about that and think that I should provide them now with some clarity, but this will not work, right? Like, I mean, I can land clarity in somebody who's on the edge, right?
Sophia, I see your hand, Sonia. But I just want to say, this is not, you have to be careful. I don't know if this is what you're saying, but it sounds like it could be that you're looking for an authority. You know, that an authority will define this. And therefore, you don't have to be the authority, because then some other authority defines it. But the way this works is a circle. There is no authority. There's no hierarchy. And so you get to define it. And people are requiring you to hold the space for them to go, you know, and it's your job. In fact,
and to question their definition of whatever.
And just before the meeting came on, and Chloe and I were saying, well, you know, pretty soon there's going to be, you know, 15 more study groups out there. And they don't all have to study this book. There's 300 books on the book list that are all great books. But for each of you to be holding a study group for your people, and what happens? Well, they build matrix and they learn to speak a new language. And that's so useful when you are the space holder. You know, going through, just like we're doing here, you know, you go through the whole thing and one step at a time, people build it out. And it's incredible the actual practical difference that shows up in people's lives just from building metrics from in a study group. Week after week, a study group is huge. Sonia, what were you going to say?
That even though the distinctions are really powerful, they will be just words if they are coming from verbal reality. And what I'm discovering is that this also happens when using possibility management distinctions, thoughtware. If people are not in experiential reality, words are just words, and they can mean several different things for the person that is using them. And what I'm discovering is that, for example, just by being in the bridge house, I'm getting much more closer to what is and to experiential reality, and integrating the distinctions of box, gremlin, survival strategies, low drama, much more than being on these calls. And these calls are pretty amazing, and they are very nourishing. And without these spaces in between the spaces, they aren't holding on to the structure that I'm creating in the calls. So I can hear all of you landing these amazing things coming through your archetypal lineage, but if there aren't spaces in between the spaces, it doesn't matter, because I will still be in verbal reality, and then experiential realities, it's kind of not matching. And then if they don't match, it doesn't move something inside of me. And the other thing that I'm experiencing, other than being in the bridge house, is holding space for other people. So for example, the women starting over, it's so incredible. Well, I'm really happy to see people in low drama, because I'm learning about low drama, and it's really rich. And this would not be possible if I was not holding space for these spaces, and if I was not in the bridge house, because I was in another culture. Even after becoming a nomad, I was going back to my mother's house while I was in Portugal, because it was safe. And now I moved from the writing house, bridge house, to the Women of Earth bridge house, and my box is going crazy. Like, I'm reactive, then people are reactive, then I don't want to be reactive because it's so wrong. And in the middle of that, I am discovering so much, but so much about how box and survival strategies block intimacy. And I'm really sad about that. I'm sad. And this pain is moving me forth to create different things, different spaces, and be here today. So, for example, now I'm just noticing I have this voice like, oh my God, you're talking so much right now. Where's your fear? You're not blocking it. And this is changing because I'm doing all these steps. I came from the writing house, then I'm doing fear club, and I'm just talking and talking, and I felt my fear. And I was just thinking, if someone else speaks after Clinton, I'm just going to say, shut the fuck up. This is me now. My fear has something to say. And I'm coming alive. I'm coming alive. And it's experiential reality. So I'm really happy about this.
So like the next paragraph in the book, it says, your innocence may be shattered through being betrayed, being abandoned, being abused, through losing something that you cherish, being stuck with something that you hate. You know, one person's innocence is shattered by being born prematurely and living their first 3 months in a plastic incubator. Another person's innocence is shattered by being sent to public school when they're 5 years old. Someone else's innocence is destroyed by the psycho-emotional terror perpetrated on their family by an alcoholic father or a choleric mother, by a disease or an accident requiring surgery, by being sexually molested, or by someone close suddenly dying, by natural disaster, the effect of war. Whatever exactly happened to you, whatever story you produce about what happened, the consequence of the wounding will be the same at the moment of the wounding as it is now if the wounding was lifetimes ago. So the result of the wounding will be objective, having the same result from person to person, and the result of your wounding is a broken heart. And in a way, Sonia, that's what you were just saying. You were just saying you're going through this and you're going through that, and everything is, you know, the survival strategy that you had is hitting the wall. And so it has to fail. If it does not fail, you don't get a new life. Like, it's like the life of a caterpillar inside of the chrysalis has to fail for the butterfly to come out. And so there's all these metaphors like that, but it's like, it really is the death and resurrection show. It really is as big as it sounds. You know, I'm not making it, I'm not over dramatizing the thing. I just want to say the reason I'm saying it like that is because we're heading towards archetypal domains. And you can't navigate archetypal domains without that level of intensity.
I bet.
Yeah, as you said, because I want everybody to hear that. I just want everyone to hear that. There's no way.
Why?
It's your job.
Is it important for them to hear that? Can you say that?
Yeah, because school made us believe, like Sonia is saying, that we have to do it right or not wrong or not again or not too long or not too loud or whatever. That's all bullshit. Mm. And my fears, they allow this in the space, in their bodies, in the emotional healing process, even there, when it's really for free and I'm here and I'm just here to hold space for you. Why would you have to do it right? I don't give a fuck if I understand or not. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just makes me so sad because I make it a priority. I make time for it. I will travel tomorrow. I don't want to waste my time discussing with gremlins some nonsense.
Thank you.
Would you keep saying that, Habet? Like, whenever, you know, you're holding space for someone to hit the wall, like, or for their survival strategy to hit the wall, or for people to hit bottom, which I guess is kind of this thing, the strategy, hit the wall so that you can hit bottom. Is it, you just tell them what you just said. You just, yeah. Yeah. And then you, this disarm, for me, that has disarmed so many gremlin comments.
Oh.
Because the person, like, there's this possibility of, God, somebody really is holding space for me. Like, somebody, it really, my gremlin will not work here.
Mm.
And okay, well, there might be a lot of fear, but it's like, okay, well, if there's fear, then that's it. Then that's where we are together.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we came for.
Yeah.
We wanted more fear, right? We paid money for more fear. Here we go. Thank you.
Thank you, Habet.
Kian and Sage, hello.
Hello.
How's it going over there? We're in pretty deep over here, but how's it going over there?
Well, I'd like to say I just appreciate being here. I've touched possibility management through three people here at the farm where I live, and I love the way that it lives in them. And so I'm just really intrigued and really grateful to be here. I always find these jewels and gems in my life when I see it, how something is living in someone, and that attracts me. Like, there's an aliveness and a authenticity and a capacity to really bring themselves forward in really beautiful ways. And so I was in conversation with Kian yesterday, and I just said, I think I want to take a step further. I think I want to find out more about this. And so the invitation was to join this call today and get up at 3:30 in the morning here and show up. And I was so excited. I woke up early before my alarm even went off. And I was like, okay, this is really something. And you know, just how my body responds is always something I follow, because my body, I feel, is so intelligent. Like, so when I feel this kind of aliveness and excitement and curiosity, that's where I am. And I'm really, this is the first time I've experienced any group conversation in this dream. And, you know, and I feel really enlivened by it, and intrigued, and definitely want to move into more experiential places. And I can really feel, I'm glad I actually came in this way, because I feel like I've come into the heart of something, the pulse of something that is, my passion has always been group work, community building. I've lived in group settings almost all my adult life. And that always draws me is how do we evolve as a group? And as a person sitting here, not knowing your language, like I had to say to Kian, what's a knit? I didn't know what it was. I was like, what are they talking about? And I could sort of guess, but I wasn't sure. But it was like, I'm feeling really comfortable that I don't know. And I'm actually excited because I want to get, I really, what keeps me alive, I'm 75 years young, I call myself, and growing. And to be comfortable with not knowing, because that's where my edges are, that's where my growth is. And I can just feel, I've been looking for a greater culture to grow myself further in, because I know that I can get stuck in my boxes. I do understand that. I don't want to have things a certain way. So I really appreciate the invitation to bring myself forward here, and really delighted to see all of you and see how what you're doing is living. So thank you, I really appreciate it.
You are welcome, man. You are welcome.
And Sage, we are exploring all those distinctions and words, even knits, in the Women's Possibility team. It's every Friday, and you're welcome to join.
Thank you.
And Sage will join an introduction to Rage Club Friday the 9th in Nelson, British Columbia.
Nice.
And I'm so glad. I'm just tearing up just hearing you, Sage. I've spent the last 10 months just spending so much time with Sage. And you've probably noticed already, but she's a sorceress witch with so much that, like, humble wisdom pouring forth, and I'm just so glad that she's starting this context and gets to know about it. Yeah, and to get to share it with her.
Thank you. In reality, it's a rare opportunity, and sometimes it amazes me that there's not 1,000 people in this space, you know. Where is everybody? And I can't understand that. I cannot understand that. Except that somehow there's a lesson from reality in that. And I don't know what the lesson is exactly. If I think it's a scary lesson. But in any case, you know, people are not knocking on our door, breaking down the door, saying we're the witch hunters. We're going to take you away to the church and try you in a, you know, Inquisition or something like that. It's not happening. So we have this rare opportunity where we can be this far away from the ordinary and really stand on the edge and hold space for that to unfold and make artifacts. Every recording that we get up online and and make available to people, it could stay there a while. You know, it could stay there quite a while. And over time, thousands of people get to go through the door. And so that's why every time you take a risk here, put dangerous stuff on the table, get vulnerable, ask questions where there's no answer, those are really precious jewels and artifacts that we're leaving behind for people to find their way, even when modern culture, ordinary people, can offer them no map. You know, we're not trying to fix people or put people back together the old way. We're trying to build opportunities or spaces where people can unfold themselves in new ways. And the potential of human beings to become unfolded in new ways is vast. It's vaster than most people ever imagine. And we're really building out game world spaces and processes and language vocabulary and distinctions and whole parts of the culture that are holding the new unfolding in a way that is stable and it's grounded, stable and grounded and really new. And so I'm really glad that there's so much intelligence and so much whatever effort, like really previous research brought together here for and shared here for other people to use. So thank you for being part of that. Is there somebody who has a line in the script right now?
I want to say something about, I was listening to the last study group and there's still something, I'm still in open spaces from the past. And last study group was this end of this chapter of Beyond Repair. And people were speaking about how that touched their life. And I just feel this impulse to also share about it. Because the last 10 weeks or however long that was have really have had such a, the context of possibility management had such a deepening function for me of the to getting what this context is about, even though I think you were speaking, Clinton and Chloe and everybody else was speaking about what it is about for 4 years. But somehow the distinctions that were coming up through these last 10 weeks, it made it possible for me to walk into this experience of this new culture and kind of start having one foot in there and start owning the ground in some way of the groundlessness, that it's an ongoing unfolding of the culture which only unfolds through my participation in it. So to me, walking and speaking about this culture and the unfolding and the distinctions and learning to live them actually in relationship. And that's also where this living in community, offering spaces about it comes in and learning to work with other people and trying to figure out what this stuff actually means, the culture and the power of these distinctions became accessible. Mm-hmm. And it's so mind-blowing. I remember, like, Clinton, you held this space for me, I don't know, 4-5 years ago, the first healing session with you. I don't know if you remember that. And it was just this journey of taking, like, totally breaking me out of this shell, this life that I lived in. And you said stuff like, basically, the life you live is to fulfill the expectation of your parents. What are you doing with your life? And I walked around for a week totally depressed and just like, with my head like down and being like, God, what have I done? But this pain has since then kept me going, and just in the last, in the last 10 weeks really, or maybe since the beginning of Rage Club or Space Holder training with Chloe, I feel like there's this fruit ripening in me, and there's just, like, I feel so, like, there's so deep love for what this is, what this journey that we're on is, and what you've done, and what you, Clinton, have done, and you and Chloe done to me in this time, and what you dare to to shred what you've dared to be a propeller blade for. And so somehow this being of mine could come out a tiny bit more. And now I get to be that for other people. And it's such a, I feel really moved, but really like just like ecstatic and sad and love. And I want to say another thing, and that is, I want to practice that. So I'm just going to try this. Like, I think three spaces ago, Clinton, you said something to me about God, something about your heartbreak is fake. And I just got hooked about through the whole space. Yeah, I need to.
You're waking up.
I'm waking up the neighbors. So.
You can blame me.
Fight them.
You can just blame me. If you come to Bali and knock at my door. And
so I made three processes about it, and I found a lot of jewels about this thing of there's something about authority, my dad, whatever, not appreciating my being, but what it still stays with me, there's this anger, because I'm discovering in the last 3 weeks I'm holding space for people, but also in my own process, that there is a quality of welcoming people's beings into the world that I'm now holding space for, and that I haven't to experience myself, and haven't happened, like just people pop up around me who need to go through this process of being welcomed with their being at some place. And it's such a like there's something about when a being gets born, and I'm just seeing that also with what ripples through Devin somehow through the village at the moment, posting about these beings that are born in Lakesh, in this community in Mexico. And there's something that is about beings coming in the world that breaks people's heart. And if that doesn't happen, if your heart is not, like if you don't experience that the village around you has a broken heart by you coming into the world, you're missing this experience. Missing this experience, and for the rest of your life you will resent your village because they haven't welcomed you. They haven't let their heart break. And it can happen now, it can happen again.
I have another thing about the village which weaves in with Kian and Habet. The question that you brought, Habet.
Sonia, will you just hold on a second?
Yes.
Just hold on. This stuff that Kian just said is so big and so profound and so well said. I'd really like to just let it hit the space a little more. Just wait a second. I don't know how many of you remember when a part of your being was born and your village welcomed you, and you may have been in so much of a liquid state you did not even notice the village welcoming you. And I certainly remember those times being unfolding in villages in surprising ways that people were not expecting, and there was really kind of nobody there to welcome me, and basically I kind of had to welcome myself in a way. Like my parents could not do it, the trainer could not do it, the other participants could not do it, and I know what was happening. And I had to kind of hold space for that thing with some kind of faith to respect that part, that new part of me unfolding. And it was like unsatisfying in a way, like you're saying, Kian, because people didn't get it. Because if they got it, they would recognize that part in them that's not born yet. Or that somebody, they did not recognize them when they were coming out like that. And it would just bring up so much for people. And so the way that you just said that, Kian, was really, touched me and was really valuable. I just wanted to hold that space for a minute in case anybody else wanted to contribute to that. Go ahead, Nicole.
I have something about that. No, it was, if Devin wrote this poem to welcome people into one of the spaces that he's holding, and I thought, I read this poem, it was basically that, it was like, oh, a new being is here in this space, we get to welcome them. And I had been wanting to go to that space, and I found out it's a day where I'm committed to something else. And I asked for an emotional healing process about it, because I was like, what? Something really big was happening to, and it was when I realized I had this fear that I would never be welcomed like that anywhere. Mm-hmm. And Nicole Nette held space for me, and I discovered I had made this decision that I hated people, that I was, and that I was better than them and smarter than them, and they could all just fuck off, and because they could not welcome me. And yeah, this thing where I would be welcoming myself, and I had like a part of my gremlin in my box was like holding space for myself in the absence of this. And there's this song that comes out of Southern Africa, and it's part of the Gods Must Be Crazy movie. Mm-hmm. I think it's on the list, isn't it?
Yes,
definitely. And where this teacher, she arrives in this village with these mud huts, these rondavels in Africa, and the bell rings because she's arrived, and they start singing this song, and it's like every time I hear it, I just want to cry, and I want to sing it, and I want to be part of a village that sings a song of welcome when I get home, you know. And I've been grieving it now that I really get it. There's this massive grief, and it's so cool because I've started noticing, like you're just talking about, Clinch, I've started noticing the welcome song of the universe and how it is in action around me, how Echo just sets up these spaces for me to go into and to be that welcome for other beings. And it's like their head snaps and they're like, what? I get to be welcomed by somebody? It's like they're starving for it. And this is like, it's such a gift to have space for that now and have eyes for it that see that instead of all the evidence that I don't belong.
Thank you, Nicole.
And I feel sad because of how that's happened in PM spaces and with you, Clinton, with you a bit, and Chloe, and I've gone, and all I've seen is evidence that I'm not welcome, and I'm totally oblivious to the fact that I already had been welcomed. But it was just like that part of me, that child that's just starving, just was insatiable. And I feel glad to know, I feel glad that it's clear now, and that it's like some plug went in the hole of that, mm-hmm. that insatiable hunger.
Ah, mm-hmm. Thank you. And on the village healing, village with healers, what's it called?
Yeah, healing village.
Yeah, this, what we're talking about, mm-hmm. should really go in there. It really needs to, it's been unaddressed.
Mm-hmm. What do you call yourself, Nicole, and also Kian, about the way you welcome the beings?
I came up with being birther.
Okay, yeah.
For me, it goes in with the evolutionary village weaver, and something about being at the gate of the village.
So you welcome people through the gate. Thank you.
And it's a little bit of a kind of, what's it called when you welcome someone and you walk along with them for a little while to kind of introduce them to, you know, like orientation, like an orienteer, village orienteer, something like that.
Or accompaniment.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was... Yeah. It's one of the words from Alexander Jodorowsky in the interview that you had with him. It's in the No Reason book. And Clinton keeps asking him, what do you really do? And he just keeps basically saying, I just accompany people. Like wherever, whatever's going on for them, I'm just accompanying them and saying, I am here with you, whatever is going on.
Oh, that's so cool. That's what came out of the mother graduation adventure. I didn't know what to call myself. And it's really accompaniment, like, cause I've graduated as a mother. I'm still graduating. I'm going to have another graduation. It never ends. So I'm with the people, I'm with the other mothers and not coaching just didn't really work. And I thought Sherpa, because, and then someone told me that the Sherpas carry the all the baggage of everyone. I'm like, I'm not doing that.
Good. Did you note from Ingrid, Nicole? Did you see the note from Ingrid? I am glad that you discover that you're welcome. It is a fact. This is reality. That is reality that you're welcome.
That's Ingrid. She like the reality of welcome.
Yes. Yes. Was there anything else from somebody else about this kind of hatching out or emergence or unfolding and the value of being recognized in that by the village or being welcomed or acknowledged? Does anybody have anything else about that?
And by experience, experimenting with folks here in Eugene, you can do a micro version of that in a moment with a hug. And the hug is that you embrace them and you just stay there.
Mark, could you say it in I?
And keep breathing.
I've
been experimenting with this. Making the hug so that it's it you go into a steady state, and I just hold that steady state. And when they're done, they let go. And it's like, great, you're done. But I've found that they get longer and longer. Like people who have had a hug from me before, the next one can go for a minute or more. So, that's part of what's happening. When they come out of it, they're not the same as when they went into the hug. And I didn't realize the rebirthing part, but there's some aspect of that where they're suddenly feeling like they were separate and just floating around in the world. And now they're here in this moment, in this space.
Thank you.
And what I'm sensing, listening, is remembering the time when my daughter was born. I never felt that vulnerable like in that time. And I never, and it's because I didn't knew. I just realized, okay, there's this being and it's called my daughter and there are certain responsibilities attached to it. But I think I was so touched by, and I, yeah, it's the first time I experienced that, being so touched by a new being in a space. And what touched me listening to you, Kian, when you were saying about the resentment or what's the village when you're not welcomed, I see myself in that. Like, I see myself with my family. I see myself with all the resentments I carried against them for like nearly all of my life, where just my being didn't felt welcome. There was so much expectations put on, so much wars going on behind. And yeah. And I'm touched. And tonight when I read to my daughter, I want to welcome her again and again and again. And I just want to see how it goes instead of being this functional reading machine, which I'm not. I'm hard judging myself, but yeah, just looking forward to this new experience with a refresh. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Just as a plus for you. Are you familiar with the Goodnight Feelings book?
Yes.
Great.
Yes, thank you.
I want to share a picture of when my first daughter was born, that my wife and I had arranged that it was us and a midwife. This is in Northern California. And the midwife was kind of busy. So I'd never even held a baby before. And here this baby's being born and the midwife's not there. So it's me. And so I'm like, you know, the baby's head is starting to come out before the midwife really comes into the space. And so, but I was essentially, I was holding this space for this emergence, this being coming into the world. And the thing that I want to share the picture of is she comes out head first and it just kind of works. And we have this warm bucket of water right there, a tub of warm water right there. So I get to bring her out into this warm tub with my hands. You know, she just like fits right in these hands. And she's just looking at me. You know, she's totally breathing, totally open. You know, her eyes are completely open. It was totally fine. She's not crying. You know, this whole hitting the babies and crying thing is just insane. You know, it's insane. And she comes out and she's welcome into this. The earth has warm water. It's not cold and hard out here and bright. You know, it's the lights were down low, the warm water's there, dad's there, mom's right there. And it's like, okay, there's a welcome happening. And I missed that. I think all of us missed having that, but just having the picture that it's possible, you know, that could have been your welcoming. It could have been the first welcoming, you know, that you could have had out here in the world. And you can kind of give it to yourself by just imagining, God, that would have been really amazing. You know, that would have been, you know, like let yourself have that as a beginning for yourself. And it's, yes, it didn't happen, but you know, whatever did happen to you is only a memory now. And you can kind of modify your memories. You can add in additional memories, kind of color the whole thing. And so I encourage people to do that sometimes.
I would add, because now that you're giving this picture, I remember, like, I've been a swimmer. So I've been in water basically since I was 8 years old or 7 years old. I've been just like living in water all the way up. I was 17, 18. And I went in the water with Clinton. Anyway, it took a little while, but Clinton went at some point said, I'm just going to hold you, like, you know, I'm laying flat and Clinton is holding me. And I remember being really freaked out about that the first couple times. And now I get this picture that this was kind of the same experience of like being in this water and being welcome and how intimate that is actually to do that with somebody. And so the experiment could also be to do it with somebody in water and just have somebody hold, just gently hold you, you know, your legs, your back, and have this eye contact and be welcome.
The watery welcome. Mm-hmm. The warm, watery welcome. Nice.
It was easy to have warm pool here in Bali, warm pool water.
Okay, then. Maybe we're going back to Sonia. Sonia, I think we're ready.
Yes. And what I was going to say, it's not fitting anymore. And I'm going to share a legend about my mother. And it's relating to when I was born. So she went to the hospital, the doctor was a man. And at some point, they wanted to use forceps to bring me out. And my mother, while she was among that pain, she started fighting him and she said no. And she kind of saved my life that day. Because my mom worked with children that have paralysis and brain malfunction because of the use of forceps.
Yeah.
And so this is a legend, and I'm honoring my mother here now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Sage.
I just wanted to share that at some point we have a hot springs here in Nelson area, and there was a woman that was training with Watsu, and she trained with a doctor that was doing rebirthing work. I was able to be held, and in a pool, she actually put me in fetal position against the wall and held my back so that I was actually back in the womb. And then she said, push off. And so I pushed off, and my body was kind of spiraling through the water. And then she was able to catch where I had been caught going through the birth canal, and just kind of tweak that. And it was a very powerful experience for me that was so somatic that it really repatterned what I had experienced. And I also felt this intense fear when I was in the fetal position in the womb. And I realized that, oh my God, that's not my fear. That was my mother's fear while I was in the womb. And that it was her, I was able to differentiate something that I couldn't differentiate when I was in the womb. And oh my gosh, that work was so powerful that it really changed a lot of the way that I viewed life. Like, I was literally rebirthed in warm water in these positions with, even sometimes I was put on the bottom of the pool and she would put her foot on my back, and these trust experiences where she had to sense when she needed to let go and I needed to surface to breathe. And so I would hit these edges of intense body fear, and then she would feel that and let me go. And so there was just this powerful work in warm water that I did over a period of time. And anyway, I just wanted to say that exists, and it's so beautiful. I really, really appreciated that repatterning on a somatic level.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For those who might be curious, it's 99 to 101 degrees. It's not the 106 hot tub. So it's not scalding hot. It's just above body temperature.
Okay, this is in Fahrenheit.
Thank you.
Fahrenheit, yes, not so.
Boiling water.
I'm going to keep reading from the book. And so this is the archetypal part of the book. For those who are jumping in or trying to jump in this part of the study group, we've already spent a year doing the ordinary and a year doing the extraordinary to prepare ourselves to enter the archetypal. And each chapter has a large warning sign going beep, 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 thinking that you can leap into the archetypal without first going through the ordinary and the extraordinary, you know, it's not going to help you. So let yourself be warned. We're talking about archetypal. We're working with archetypal and archetypal relating, archetypal being, and tapping into the archetypal nature of the universe, which is what we're human beings are actually designed on. So to move into the space of archetypal love requires the broken heart. And so if you're not at a place where you've learned to feel consciously and where it's, you have not stellated your sadness to 100% archetypal level for no reason, for as long as you want, if you don't have that capacity, you're in the wrong domain. You need to go, it's like, I don't know what, it's like bringing your mule to a Indy 500 car race and getting on the back of your donkey and thinking that you're going to participate in this race with the Indy 500 machines, you know, that are revving at 5,000 RPM and ready to. So you really need to prepare yourself to understand and to do what we're talking about here. So having a broken heart, your first reaction to the image of having a broken heart could well be revulsion, because a broken heart appears to be a weakness, a handicap, a vulnerability that saddles you with a pain. What could it mean, quote unquote, a broken heart? First of all, it is not the heart that gets broken. The heart is fine. What breaks is the agglomeration, the agglomerated encrustations around your heart that you collected so as to buffer your heart against experiencing an intensity of feelings that you thought you could never bear. So you got to get that picture that we've built this protection up and it becomes crystallized. And that's the thing that's breaking. That's the part that's breaking, is the barnacles, you know, the coral that's built around your heart that's there to like defend the heart from this kind of stuff. It's like, that's the part that breaks off for the heart to come alive, to get bigger.
What's a barnacle?
A barnacle is a sea organism that grows on the bottom of boats, that pointy thing, and that you have to scrape it off the boat. You know what I'm talking about? What is
it? Yes, thank you. What's it in
Portuguese?
I don't know if there's a name.
What is it in French? I'm sure there's a name. It's in anything. Okay, so you know what we mean. It's hard, crunchy, solid part that's built up over years to protect your heart against experiencing aliveness, because you thought you would never bear it, thought you could never handle it. So you defended your heart in order to survive. You get that, which in turn, if you concrete yourself into a survival mode, you don't get to live. But our orientation in our environment has always been about survival. We don't have examples of aliveness. We don't have bridges to aliveness. We don't have aliveness school or aliveness transition, like none of that stuff. They want you to be successful. Being successful is another way of being dead. So this aliveness is foreign to modern culture. So the thing is, you defended your heart in order to survive, and it worked because you did survive. So it's important to recognize and acknowledge that your technique worked because you did survive. Yes. Your intention was noble and successful to be able to survive. So it's not about beating yourself up that you encrusted your heart to survive, because it was noble to survive. Who else was going to survive for you? You get this? There's nobody else out there who was going to take a stand for you to survive. You did, and it worked. So it was noble. And so your intention was to take care of yourself so that you could continue to live. And you lived and you grew and you matured until that which once defended you has now become your prison. It's that simple. what may be happening now is that you are outgrowing your own defenses. The tricks that you created to stay untouchable are as irrelevant as diapers, as unnecessary as a baby bottle, as extraneous as training wheels on your bicycle. You get those things, they were all necessary for a while, but the situation's different now. The broken heart is hard earned and commonly perceived as an avoidable evil. You know, the whole, all these love songs, you know, and all this, the whole, the poetry, whatever, it's like to try to, the broken heart is problematical. And if you can avoid it, well, then that's better. So the broken heart is often something that God lets happen to you as an oversight. You know, it should not have happened. And here you have a broken heart. That's how it's commonly viewed. An extraordinary event must occur to shift a victim's view of having a broken heart to include its true value. So this extraordinary event is a change of perspective. How is one to responsibly understand and use the pain of deceit and betrayal to expand compassion rather than shrink it? How can a broken heart serve archetypal love? And this is this paradoxical situation. The answer is counterintuitive. A broken heart is so tender and raw that considering doing violence to another person or to nature feels like raw skin scraping on a hot pavement. It is not the pain of being violated, but the pain of being about to cause violence yourself that changes you. When pain about your own unconscious behavior wakes you up to the depth of your own unconsciousness, then your broken heart changes the way you behave. You care too much about the being of a person to be insulted by their box. You get this? You care too much about the being of a person so that you're unhookable from all their box stuff. You cannot be insulted by a person's box because you care too much about their being. You're with their being. Being with their being, the box is doing its thing. It's irrelevant. So why take revenge against a sleeping machine when there is a living being in there whom you could love? And you get how different this is from the ordinary and even the extraordinary of being ordinarily responsible. You know, the extraordinary relating is responsible, but then there's paybacks, you know. It's like, you did this to me, so I have to do this to you. That's fair. This is the extraordinary, actually, the way it's, that's adult level. But we're talking about archetypal level when there's a living being in there and you could love that rather than being hooked by reactivity. When you accept the unexpurgated experience of your broken heart, unexpurgated means it's unedited, like the full experience of your broken heart, there may come times when you think you want to die of overwhelm from shame or from isolation or from depression or grief or remorse, but you do not die. Instead, you live on within an intensity of experience far above what you previously defined as your maximum limit. Even if you do not know how this process works, you continue living. In these times, you have hit bottom. There it is.
There it is.
Right there. It was always there. We've been rediscovering hit bottom. And it was always there. It's amazing. In these times, you hit bottom. There's a website called Hit Bottom, great context and experiments. You have given up trying to control the circumstances and have become fluid to a level that you previously assumed would drive you crazy. And then you discover that in these times, you are to a high degree transparent to the principles that serve what is wanted and needed in the space, because your box does not care to interfere with its dreary opinions anymore. The box has become just boring, and you get to be alive in a whole different way. As paradoxical as this may sound, in my experience, the upper world is entered through the bottom of the underworld. There's this map of these worlds, that there's this middle world and underworld and an upper world. And if you're in the middle world and you die, you go to the upper world, because that's heaven, whatever. So this is some Christian church or whatever diagram of the worlds. But if you actually are in the middle world and you try to go to the upper world, like you go visit your parents at Christmas and you go and knock on the door, you should bring along a stopwatch and see how long it is before you're hooked by your parents. You know, you hit the doorbell, and as soon as that door opens, you click the stopwatch, and you see, as soon as you start feeling this reactive energy, you click it again, and you get, Jesus, I made it to 16 seconds this year. Wasn't that great, honey? You know, 16, last day it was only 4 seconds.
Before I was hooked, before I ring the bell.
You're trying to go from the middle world to the upper world, but you know what's in the way? The underworld. So the map was wrong. It goes middle world, underworld, upper world. And this up here, the top part of the underworld, is the bottom part on the inside. So you have to dig through the mud to get to the sky. It's a quote from Lee Loswick. Anyway, you discover, yes. Okay. As paradoxical as this may sound, okay, the upper world is entered through the bottom of the underworld. Your brokenheartedness gives you answers that you thought could only be found elsewhere through struggle or merit. Like the Buddhists, they try to get merit. And so you think that your brokenheartedness gives you answers, that you think that merit would give you answers, but actually it's your broken heart that gives you the answers. In those worst of times, quote unquote, worst of times, as you look back on your life, you see that having abundant compassion towards your own broken heart is what finally makes sense. Does anybody have anything about all that yet? Because it goes on, it doesn't just end there.
This last part that you read, I thought people who have this thing about the pressure, you know, it's like, I'm going to get somewhere through struggle or merit. I mean, especially through struggle. And I think working through this pressure is fear. And maybe it's just really this fear of the brokenheartedness. Like that the survival strategy of pressure is a way to avoid just being heartbroken. And so I'm taking that as, in the Fear Club and working with people who, we've learned that through pressure we would get good grades. And we think becoming human is the same, follows the same instructions.
Thank you.
I discovered that in a process that I did about my own pressure, that I was pressuring myself to not be in contact with people so that my heart would not be broken. And it was in this moment where I was just beginning to walk on with my knees, and I remember that my head was really heavy and I kept hitting my head in the carpet, and my mom was screaming, and I had this clear vision of wanting to go to her skin. And but the fear was coming in of, if I go there, she may hurt me. And this was the part of breaking my heart. And so I used the anger to not go with the impulse of going to this nurturous place that I really wanted to. And so this was active. And during one of the spaces of Fear Club, of removing blocks, I took the block out, and there will be other layers, but this was happening with everyone. It was not just with my mother.
Mm. Thank you.
Thank you.
I went over, so like this New Year's shift, Lauren, I went through a phase of having no contact at all. And it seemed like this stuff was over, basically. And so I went through this thing called a heartbreak for the first time, with the possibility to feel my feelings. And what I noticed is that for me, I needed to break my heart myself. I needed to do it. Like, it wasn't just broken. I needed to go through the resentment, through the layers of resentment and expectation that are more easy to go to for my whatever survival strategy. And I needed to go through these layers of resentment and break through them to my heart. And I think that is for, at least for me, but I think also for a lot of other people, that's a heartbreak is not something that just happens. It's something that needs to be cultivated, that needs to be attended, and needs to be sought out. And I for the first time in my life, I felt like I really went into like full on the swamp. I didn't speak to anybody for 5 days here in the community. I was just not sharing anything. And I did it because I wanted to go into the full depth of what that means to experience that without rescuing myself out of it, without trying to fix it. And I came to what you just described, Clinton, is I came to this place where I saw that my revenge strategy was not worth not loving this being. I needed to have time. I needed to have to sit with this and break it down so I could see that. And then there comes this, it's a crazy experience. There comes this experience of seeing my whole, how I became, how I survived in this light of archetypal love, and how it's in the way, how it's like covering this archetypal love that could happen. And to be in this unbearable split between those two, that needs to be bought, like that I need to stay in for some time so this thing can dissolve. And and the interesting part, now I feel like this is now my practice, to keep staying in that split of seeing all this stuff, seeing all these things from the past, and living with the attention and awareness that there is something else possible, and it's only possible through staying in this heartbreaking space for the rest of my life.
Like it says, hit bottom and stay there. It's a kind of glorious thing to say for the rest of my life, because what I found is it becomes familiar or normal or acceptable. And in fact, it goes further, you know. And so it's not like the end, you didn't hit the candy store yet. You know, there's the next one and the next one and the next one. But you don't, you know, what we don't do, it like you can't you can't get to the next one except by staying on the edge of that one. You really have to stay at the edge of it. If you go back off, like Anne Chloe says, you go into the marshmallow zone, you go into this buffer zone, and you try to protect your survival strategy from the world, so that like you build up this construct. A lot of handsome, holy tribal men types in the feminine version are doing that. They're training people how to build up this buffer zone to protect their survival strategy from reality. And then it just complicates matters. And what we're talking about is really forget the marshmallow zone and like let your survival strategy hit reality, like you said, Kian, exactly the way you described. And then reality will take it apart because the survival strategy is not real. It's necessary for a time, but it's not real. And so then as it comes apart, then the emergence can happen. So thank you. Somebody gonna say something? Okay. If you practice delaying your reflexive moves, like reflexive means automatic, you know, and your knee's hanging on the table and the doctor hits it with a hammer and your leg goes like this. That's a reflex. It just happens every single time. This is reflex. And so if you practice delaying the reflexive move, the try to patch up the cracks in your heart, then the heart will gradually relax into staying open even when it hurts. And I think that's what you're talking about too, Kian. I think we've been talking about it stays open even when it hurts. You develop distinctions between the different kinds of hurting. Is it fear? Is it rage? Is it sadness? Is it joy? Is this a feeling or is it emotion from the past or somebody else? Is this my pain or someone else's pain? Is this feeling mixed together with other feelings or is it a pure emotion? Is it mixed emotions or pure emotions? How big is it? What percentage big is it? All of this stuff informs you. It's inner navigating. Accepting your own broken heart is a new experience. Your whole body may find empathy, may become unpredictably kind and generous to yourself and other people who are in these states. You know, I remember plenty of times going through this kind of stuff where, you know, somebody who just is a nuisance to me, all of a sudden I have this huge compassion for them and clarity about what's going on because I went through something like that, you know, and I go, oh my God, I was pretending like you were a problem. And in fact, there you are. You're really more present and real than I was. And so I've even gone to those people and apologized sometimes, just say, I just didn't get it before. So I'm sorry. So, because your whole body can find empathy and become kind and generous or may sense what is happening in your proximity if it is happening to itself, not because your heart wants to feel these things, but by the very fact that your heart is broken and no longer protected with a sense of already knowing certainty. That's what part of the protection is. I already know this. I already get this. Because you don't have that anymore. The broken heart opens to wide band exchange. Wide band means multiple frequencies. Normally, a lot of times, especially in the intellectual body, we have these really narrow bands of connecting with people, really a narrow band. But with a heart level, you can open to wide band. You know, you probably had this experience. You look, I look at a dog or I look at an ant. You know, and the ant is scared or the dog is pissed off or, you know, I'm looking at a tree and the tree is being encroached by another tree. You know, I have this wide band compassion for stuff that's happening in nature or around me with other beings. And I never, you know, I would block all that before because my heart was encrusted. When you start knocking the crust off, you start getting this wide band sense of connection. both with other people and with specific situations and all these encounters. It's a new kind of energetic flow through your heart. How many people have been experiencing that in the last while? You get this whole new level of flow through. Yeah. So sooner or later, you come to discover that the experiences that shattered your innocence and eventually broke your heart open gave you the exact reference points and sensitivities that you need to serve others with your archetypal lineage and your bright principle and to fulfill your destiny. Your pain has been your apprenticeship. Now, keep in mind, we're not recommending going off and abusing yourself or letting other people abuse you so that you get apprenticeship. That's not what this is about at all. So do not confuse that. But the universe is wise in many ways and opens a lot of doorways. And I've been working on this novel called Cavitation, and in the last couple of months, I've been in Syria, in Aleppo, which is, most of us have no idea what's really been going on for the last 13 years in Syria. Well, since 2011, yeah. And it's because modern culture news has, it's not market worthy, whatever. It's just the only use of it is to sell more weapons or something. It's insane. But for this story, I have to go live in there. I'm living in Aleppo now. I've got like 30% of myself over in Aleppo. And it's been a condensed of these last 13 years is condensed for me. And it's like, I don't get it. How people have been given, 6 million people have left Syria in the last decade. And that's a quarter of the population of the country. They have left. They've just, everything's broken, everything's ruined, everything's destroyed, house, their identity, their family, you know, dead, destroyed, just obliterated. And they've just had to leave the country. And you know, for most people, you know, for a nomad, like I had to work decades to become a nomad. I had to let go, be able to let go of things enough to be a nomad. Well, these people, the rug is pulled out from under them and it's not their choice. It's just like their life has been killed. So either they stay there and die or they leave. And so 6 million people have decided to leave. 6 million people are just homeless walking around the country. And so it's like, you've got 13 million people. I mean, we don't even understand what a million is. Cannot even comprehend that number. Our mind is not big enough. Yet there's 13 million refugees from the last 12 or 13 years in Syria. And the rest of the people are living in these hell worlds. And it's incredible to try to imagine, okay, how is ECHO working here? How is the Earth Coincidence Control Office trying to open doors and offer people opportunities for the evolution of consciousness or healing a broken heart? Okay, how is this working over there? And I don't know. I have no theory or I don't get it. I'm not going to go over to Syria and hang out in the wrecked out buildings of people shooting each other with AK-47s and dropping barrel bombs on. I mean, it's just insane. What I'm not going to go over there and try to figure it out like that. But there are these things happening on Earth where it's like, okay, how can one comprehend and make sense out of it? When you know, I wrote this book back in, I don't know what, 2010 or something, in 2007, it was before all, you know, I was aware of all this stuff. And so it's like, okay, a broken heart becomes a gateway to archetypal relating. All right, how does that work for somebody in Syria? Are they really being given this opportunity? Like, what does one have to do to sit in a space like this and consider this as a reality and actually work with it and produce results? Like, how are you going to walk out of here and start relating archetypally with some people in your lives? How are you going to do that in reality? Not just as a fancy idea or something to tickle your fancy with as a concept, but actually doing that, how are you going to do that? And then it says, you have to accept the totality of your heart's brokenness. So there's a difference between accepting brokenheartedness as a permanent condition and enduring a broken heart as a temporary strategy, just long enough to get through a moment of anguish. I mean, enduring a broken heart is conditional, but archetypal love is unconditional. Archetypal love cannot land in a relating space that you hold until you are willing for it to be there forever. Chip, what does that even mean? Like, how are you able to endure that kind of intensity? Like, how can you stand it forever? So archetypal love cannot land in the relating space you hold until you're willing for it to be there forever. And then archetypal love comes and goes as it pleases. By trying to endure a temporary broken heart without accepting an irreparably broken heart, the wall towards archetypal love stays in place. So the level of the game, the level, this is physics. This is like the physics of archetypal love. A man's broken heart exposes him to unspeakably precious experiences that were too frightening for a heart guarded by reactionary machine guns. Experiences that were previously too intense become suddenly too temporary. Tenderly caressing the aliveness in your woman's hand enchants you endlessly. Within the field of your delicate attentions, her she-ness unfolds into none other than the true archetypal feminine, the astounding goddess, the same one who was Mary Magdalene to Jesus, who was Shakti to Shiva, who was Radha to Krishna. This radiantly alluring she being stands in relationship to you, and every cell in your system tingles with that connection. You smell the musky warmth of her skin. You stroke the electric tangles of her hair. Maximum womanliness fully and richly responds to your glance. She speaks into your fortunate ears. She willingly spends precious moments of her life sharing ordinary chores with you, washing the dishes, you know, even eating or walking, while exuding flawless beauty. So she willingly spends precious moments of her life sharing ordinary chores with you while exuding flawless beauty, every breath and gesture only full of love. She envelopes you in her nurturing and healing balm of legendary proportions, the taste of which you can neither absorb enough nor appreciate enough. Being too close aches as much as being too distant, and yet she is the focus of your unquenchable longing when you appreciate and accept your broken heart. End of section 8D. Page 259. Thank you for being here tonight. Does anybody have any closing words?
Yeah, that section really touched me.
Can you say more about that?
Struggling to kind of distill between what my fantasy is and what the real longing of the being is. And I really sensed in those words that it was just that simple without any more stories than that. And that's why it really touched me. I could really sense the longing for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to share that that really touched me, and I really appreciate the depth of connecting the depth of the broken open heart with the ecstatic communion with, you know, the beauty of that principle. And this I can really feel in my being the way it touches me is this feeling of opening to the agony and the ecstasy of a living heart. And I thank you for sharing that. It really will live with me, and it lives in my experience as well as in my longing. So thank you.
Thank you.
Sage.
There's these moments that can go by pretty quickly in our what seems to be an ordinary world, but if you ever get a chance to eat a really good mango, or if you get a chance to see a bird in ecstasy, or if you see, you know, if you get to see a child smile at another child, or if you get to see a dog play or a cat play or something, like these moments that go by really quickly, if you can use those for doorways, that would be an experiment this week, is to really try to capture those moments in terms of noticing them and hang in there, like hang in the moment without trying to verbalize, oh, go, that's a cat playing, you know, that's a bird, you know, that's a mango, I'm eating a mango, put it in verbal reality, and then the experience is gone. Instead, try to hang out in the actual doorway that you get from that, that gets opened for a moment, and just see if you, how many breaths you can take before your mind comes in and just destroys it with ordinary. That would be an experiment this week, is to notice how many archetypal doorways are opened up for us in our daily life, and see how long you can, how much of your anatomy you can stick through the door before the door closes. Game over. Hello, Doris. We're all leaving. It's nice to see you, but we're leaving anyway.
You're muted, Doris.
Reality, electronics. Goodbye, everybody.
Yeah, I came on over my phone because I've seen it right now in the morning that it's going on, and I had that impulse to come in. Sorry for coming in at the end, but I'm glad to see you both.
Well, it's been a
while. I'm in a huge learning about all you taught me. Thank you.
Okay. See you next week.
See you, everybody.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Goodbye. Bye-bye.